Hi, I'm Matt, and this is my dad, Emeritus Professor Charles Griffiths. He's an expert in marine biology and has found a ton of new species. And together, we're going to explore the shore.
The feather stars are another interesting group of echinoderms. And in this group, the animal has actually turned the other way up. So instead of its tube feet facing downwards, its mouth and its tube feet are now facing upwards into the water. And it's actually developed another set of limbs on its back. And those are used to hold onto the rock. So the animal faces upwards, holds its legs up into the water and intercepts little pieces of food that are floating along. And then it passes them from tube foot to tube foot down to the mouth, which is in the center of the body. So it looks more like a flower, actually, with very long petals that are facing upward.
I imagine that people probably see them and think that they're a plant or something.
Yes, you could easily mistake it for an alga, for a seaweed. The body is actually very small, so there isn't room in the body to accommodate the gonads, the reproductive organs. The reproductive organs get displaced into the bases of the arms, or in fact into the little projections from the bases of the arms. So if the arm is like a branch, then it has these little twigs, or little leaves branching off the side of the arm, and in those leaves are situated the reproductive organs. The actual reproductive process is, like in pretty much all echinoderms, is a broadcast spawning. Okay. So they would release the eggs and sperm into the water at some sort of synchronized signal, and then the eggs meet the sperm and create a larva which then swims around and finds a new area to settle.
Does anybody know how they signal to each other? Because they all spawn at the same time.
They have to spawn at the same time. Synchronized. So this is one of the things about broadcast spawning. So everybody has to know when to go. So there has to be a signal, and that it's a hormonal signal. Some hormones are secreted that tells everybody to get ready and make their eggs and sperm all nice and ripe. And then there'll be another sort of instant signal which says, okay, ready, steady, go. And then everybody spawns and their eggs and sperm meet in the water. And these can be quite spectacular events. You may have seen movies about corals on the Great Barrier Reef all spawning on one particular night of the year, and the whole water is just filled with eggs and sperm. And a similar sort of thing would happen on a smaller scale with these groups of echinoderms. And they can swim. They're the only group of echinoderms, well, except for a very few deep water sea cucumbers, they're the only echinoderms that can swim. So if you pick them off the rocks, they actually kind of flap their arms rather elegantly like a bird and then move to a new spot. So they tend to settle on very open and exposed areas and then hold their arms out into the water.
Because they're filter feeding, so they need a good...
They need to intercept particles in the water. So some ancient feather stars actually had a stalk. So they had their little group of roots that attached them to the rock, and then they had a long stalk, and at the top of the stalk was situated the animal. So they were called sea lilies, and actually a few of them still exist in the very deep ocean, but you don't see them in the shoreline. In brittle stars, the arms have become very long and thin and slender, and of course very brittle, that's how they get their name. And they move, instead of using their tube feet, they kind of row with their arms like this. It's like a snake moves along. And so they're using the entire arm instead of just the tube feet. It's a different mode of locomotion, and here's some doing it quite nicely here.
Cool. So they're also echinoderms, yeah? The same five, I can see the five sides.
Yes. So they're echinoderms, they're quite similar to starfish, but the body is much more separate from the legs. So the body has become quite small and round, and then the legs have become very elongate and very bendy and mobile, and of course brittle.
I've seen one or two with their legs broken off. I guess they come off a lot easier.
That's correct. Echinoderms are all quite good at regenerating organs that are broken. So just as starfish can grow new legs if their legs get broken off, so you very often see a brittle star with one or more tiny little legs that are just starting to regrow. And they'll happily break legs off and regenerate them many times in their lives. One of the interesting things about the brittle stars that we get in Cape Town here is that a couple of the species actually give birth to live young. So they have five chambers, because everything is five-fold in brittle stars. They have five chambers in which the eggs develop into fully formed little brittle stars, which then emerge through a slit in the ventral, the bottom side of the animal, as fully formed little animals.
Wow, so they got like whole little babies inside them. How many? Is it a lot that they have inside?
The babies are not synchronized, which is quite interesting. So you can actually x-ray an individual brittle star and look at the babies inside of them. And you'll find some babies that are very well developed. And then in other ovaries, there'll be other babies that are still in the egg stage or in the early stages of development. Cool. So you can have 10 or 15 babies at different stages of development in the five ovaries around the animal.
How crazy that these brittle stars are growing their young inside them. There's always something amazing down here.